This presentation gives an overview of deep incarnation. What is deep incarnation? The term was first used by Niels Gregersen nearly 20 years ago, and since then it's been developed by Gregersen himself and by other eco-theological thinkers such as Dennis Edwards, Elizabeth Johnson and Celia Dean Drummond. Perhaps the most extensive discussion of deep incarnation to date is a recent volume edited by Gregersen called Incarnation, which includes work from the other three thinkers who I just mentioned. The most central claim of deep incarnation is that the incarnation is an event which occurs so deeply within creation that it can be said to be an incarnation into the very tissue of biological existence and system of nature. That's a direct quote from Gregersen. The essence of deep incarnation, then, is that the Logos of God, in Trinitarian terms, the Eternal Son, became flesh in Jesus of Nazareth and assumed, that is, took on, a particular body and mind, and in doing so also took on the material, living and mental conditions of being a creature. Let's unpack what that means. One central thing that deep incarnation points to is the very obvious but also easily overlooked fact that the body of Jesus has a shared biological existence, not only with all human beings, but with the rest of the created order. Jesus, like us, was a biological being. Neil Darragh describes Jesus as a function in the carbon and oxygen cycles of the planet, a mammal, an event in the production-consumption processes of first century Palestine, and so on. This is an ecologically helpful invitation to see Jesus and all people, ourselves included, as existing not only in the category of the human, but in other categories too. For example, seeing ourselves as vertebrates, mammals, carbon, so larger categories than the human. Recognizing the commonalities, rather than the differences, between human and other than human, is a reminder of the way that various parts of the Earth community are interrelated. It also reminds us of how much we depend on the biophysical world. So seeing Jesus in this way is itself ecologically significant because it can serve as a reminder that we too are part of the created world, that at one level at least, the world forms us, that we depend on it, and that we neglect it at our peril. So an affirmation of Jesus of Nazareth's biophysical status has some relevance for ecological ethics, and that's important. But in isolation, it does little more than provide a kind of environmental footnote to the Jesus of History project. That is to say, it fails to take into account the universal significance of the event of the incarnation. A reminder of the biophysical nature of Jesus is not the only or the primary thing that deep incarnation is claiming. Deep incarnation also makes the important point that Jesus Christ reveals the divine Logos through and in himself. That means that the event of Jesus Christ is both particular and universal. The particular and the universal exist together, they're united. It's not just that Jesus of Nazareth was composed of matter, but that as Logos, Jesus Christ is able to hold all things, and that means all kinds of matter, living or otherwise, together within the matrix of materiality that we share with other beings. This means that instead of focusing on Jesus of Nazareth as a figure of history, or seeing him just as one example among billions of the fact that humans have a biophysical constitution, Jesus Christ, not only Jesus of Nazareth, but Jesus Christ, is genuinely synchronous with each creature in time and is what is said to be co-inherent in all that exists in time and space. And this connection of Jesus with all that exists has clear ethical implications. As Elizabeth Johnson notes, because the Word of God enters solidarity with the whole of creation, therefore people of faith become aligned with God in caring for creation. So the incarnate body of Jesus is not restricted to his earthly ministry, but his body does profoundly relate to his earthly ministry. As Elizabeth Johnson says, deep incarnation is about emphasizing the tangible physical quality of Jesus's ministry, life, death, and resurrection. Think about Jesus's work of healing and feeding, his suffering and death on the cross, and his bodily resurrection. That life and work of Jesus relates to all bodies and all matter at all times, so that the solidarity of Jesus is with the whole created world. The resurrection is pivotal for making that connection between the tangibility of Jesus' physical existence and the eternal dimension of the Logos. So again, it's about the particular and the universal coming together. Drawing on the thought of Karl Rahner, Johnson notes that in the incarnation, the divine Logos becomes material forever. The incarnation reveals something about who God is. Gregerson argues that Jesus is the character description of who God is. So this tells us something about the nature of God and how God is, not only during the historical incarnation, but also well before and after that time. If Jesus is the character description of God, then the particular event of Jesus Christ cannot be segregated from a universal expression of God in the cosmos in general. To say that Jesus, like other human beings, is interdependent with the life system of this planet is also to point to God's action throughout all of creation. To say that another way, and to summarise this section on what deep incarnation is, it is precisely because in Jesus the Word of God became enfleshed as part of the universe that the claims about the sarx, that is the flesh, of Jesus of Nazareth being a complex unit of minerals and fluids, or an item in the carbon, oxygen and nitrogen cycles, or a moment in the biological evolution of this planet, that phrases like that become meaningful for Christian faith and takes it out of being a simple anthropological truism that applies to all and every human being. It might be thought that the idea of deep incarnation is recent. And certainly the term itself is less than 20 years old, and it can be seen as new because it is relevant to contemporary ways of understanding the world. For example, evolutionary theory, which tells us that historically and biologically, our existence derives from and depends on the rest of the natural world. Also, the science of ecology perceives a web of life existing within ecosystems that link with each other. So deep incarnation is an idea that resonates with current understandings and seems to be new from that perspective. But deep incarnation is not only a new idea, it also relates to much older ideas. Gregerson claims that his intention is to draw on the theology of the patristic era, and indeed the idea that the resurrection of Jesus Christ points to the way that the whole cosmos is destined for redemption can be traced to patristic thinkers such as Ambrose of Milan. The ideas of deep incarnation are also found in literature that is not specifically eco-theological. For example, in 1986, John Paul II said that the incarnation has a cosmic significance and dimension. So deep incarnation is important for eco-theology, in part because it plays down the way that the Christian tradition has too often focused on the human dimension of the incarnation, the human meaning of the incarnation. The message of deep incarnation, that there is a correspondence between Jesus Christ and the broader world of matter, has some connections with the basic idea of ecological theology that reality is triangular. It's not just about God and humankind, it's about God, humankind, and the whole of creation. The whole earth community is part of God's compass, part of God's embrace. God's transformative presence is not only for humankind, but for the world at large. Richard Borkham notes that some of the most remarkable passages of Christological reflection in the New Testament speak of the relevance of Jesus Christ not only to other humans, but also to the whole of the non-human creation. In deep incarnation, matter is blessed, affirmed, and seen as the locus of God's presence, as a permanent reality of who God is. This resonates with the claim made in ecological theology that matter matters, to use the title of a book by Paul Collins, that the stuff of the world is of intrinsic or inherent value. And this has a clear relationship to a positive environmental ethic of ecological sensibility and care. Now, theology is always open to being reviewed and revised, and there is at least one aspect of deep incarnation which calls for further discussion and exploration. That is the need to clarify the relationship between incarnation and immanence. It's not possible to discuss that question fully here, but just in order to not give a purely positive interpretation of deep incarnation, I'll just give a brief summary of this issue here. Basically, in the incarnation, the Logos is incarnate in the world at least in a particular way. And in immanence, God is immanent to at least some extent in the natural world through ongoing creation and also through special events such as the burning bush in the Moses story. But this begs the question of whether in deep incarnation, incarnation and immanence really mean the same thing. If so, then is deep incarnation really a kind of pantheism? Is there a claim that God is immanent in everything, all the time and in all ways? And it begs the question of whether, if God is incarnate in all that is God also incarnate in occurrences such as the bombing of Hiroshima, in a rape, in a terrorist attack? The main proponent of deep incarnation, Niels Gregersen, is well aware of this issue, and his most recent work gives the question a central place. Gregersen does at times seem to imply that incarnate essentially means immanent. Yet he rejects pantheism and pan-incarnationalism. Certainly, he would say that God is already immanently present to the world, but not in an undifferentiated and constant way, as would be the case in pantheism, but out of freedom, that is, in historical and particular ways. With regard to the question of whether God is present in events of human evil and in suffering creation, most proponents of deep incarnation say that God is to be seen as present with human beings and with the whole of creation in their suffering. You may have noticed here and at other points in this presentation that in deep incarnation, and perhaps this is also true of discourse around incarnation itself, prepositions are extremely important. Gregersen says it is one thing to say that the incarnate Christ is present in, with, and for all created beings, in particular the victims of creation and creativity. But it is quite another to say that God is incarnate as a terrorist attack, as a rape, or as a natural disaster. Gregersen also says Christ is present as the embodied Logos in the world of creation for other creatures. This reliance on prepositions and how they are used makes deep incarnation subject to nuance and complexity, and is part of the reason why discussion around it is not easy, even though it's an important and ongoing topic. So, to summarise and conclude, the central claim of deep incarnation is that the incarnation occurs so deeply within creation that it is in fact an incarnation into the very tissue of biological existence and system of nature. It's a complex idea to get our heads around, but that is the main claim of deep incarnation. Jesus, like us, was a biophysical being who evolved from and was physically dependent on the natural world. In the incarnation, God entered biological life in a new way and continues to be present with creation through the process of evolution, not only with humankind, but with ecosystems and with the entire biosphere. Therefore, Christ is representative of the universe as well as humanity, and so Christ unifies all that is. The focus in deep incarnation is less on humankind in isolation from the natural world or in an elevated position above it, but rather on humankind as an integral part of creation. An implicit focus is also on the inherent value of the material world as the locus of the divine in the incarnation. Deep incarnation is an important development for ecological Christology. It balances creation with incarnation and shows the profound connection between them. Although there is still much work to do in the burgeoning area of deep incarnation, it is a promising field of study which positions ecological theology both within contemporary understandings and within the ambit of traditional Christian texts.